Gee, Shrek, guess where we're at today? We're in the heartland today, and I tell you what, we're at a place called the Steamboat Arabia Museum. We're gonna go inside today and see one of the greatest collections, memorabilia, anywhere. If you can imagine a Walmart in 1856, that's exactly what we're gonna do. So come along with us when we journey on our road trip to the many, many areas of history during the Civil War era. It's gonna be an incredible journey.
Steam engines rolling, boilers boiling up the Mississippi and down the Ohio. This is the ballad of the steamer of Arabia, the story of her seasoned crew. Through snags and danger, their boys were never strangers to living by the river's rules. Boilers boiling, engines rolling up the Mississippi and down the Ohio. She was loaded to the brim, whiskey, guns, and sin. Get yourself a brand new pair of shoes. Ramblers and gamblers, dreamers and schemers, captain and his faithful.
Jay Shrek, you're not going to believe where I am at today. I'm in a place in Kansas City, Missouri called the River Key, which is kind of in the bottoms of Kansas City. And I'm in a place that's very special to me because I have connections to this place. And if you look right here, what you're going to see is you're going to see a paddle wheel from a side paddle boat. And I'm in the Arabia Museum that a friend of mine, you know, and actually a classmate's family and him dug the steamboat Arabia, and it was completely intact. And I'm telling you what, this is a really an incredible place. It's a great story, and we're gonna get in here and we're gonna talk about the steamboat Arabia that sunk here and was found in a field like 40 feet down. How incredible is that? So walk with me as we come in here and we see the museum in the River Key of Kansas City of the steamboat Arabia. You know, the steamboat Arabia on September 5th, 1856, hit a snag on the Missouri River about 10 miles north of Kansas City and sunk in 15 feet of water. Now, even though there were no fatalities other than the mule who was tied to the deck, all that cargo was sealed for decades, which is just an incredible story. And all that stuff was left. And that family hunted that boat down and found it. And the story of the Arabia is just absolutely fantastic. It's unbelievable. It was not the first steamboat that this group had dug. The first did not have any cargo, but one thing it did have was the world's oldest steam engine. You know, when searching for the boat, you would think it would be in the water, but the reality of it was in a cornfield. And the only way to find it was to use a proton magnetometer. Now, what this is basically a large metal detector. And there's magnetic values everywhere on Earth, and what this does is be able to find them. You know, and they searched the farm for several hours until David came across what we call a hot spot. You know, maybe where the iron machinery lay. You know, the next step was to determine how deep the boat was. And even though it could find the iron boilers, it would not tell us how deep the boat was. The next step in the process was to drill the ground and then flag it to try to find a outline. Now, this was a very tedious process, and it took a long time. But when they were done, they were able to say exactly where they thought, how deep, and how wide across the boat actually was. You know, the most challenging and expensive part of the excavation was that when they were about 10 feet down, they hit groundwater because the boat was surrounded by a huge aquifer that had made the salvage efforts before that unobtainable. You know, it's incredible when you see this hull right here and you realize that they used, you know, great steam ovens to twist that hull and that wood to make the hull of the Arabia. Isn't that incredible? As it comes across, And you look at that and you realize that how incredible this construction of this boat is. And also the fact that this boat still is even available in here. Isn't that incredible? Look at this, how beautiful this is.
Well, you can see the work being done by our team of preservationists. The
If you look up there, it was known basically as the Great White Arabia. And if you look closely, you can still see the paint. And you can imagine when this boat was coming down the river, you know, how majestic it was and how beautiful it was, how incredible this boat really was. And if we look over here real quick, what we're going to find out is we're going to kind of see the history a little bit of the Arabia. You know, it was built in Brownsville, Pennsylvania, and in 1853. And then worked the Ohio and Mississippi in 1853 to 55. And then 55, Captain William Terrill buys the Great White Arabia to ferry cargo from the Missouri River, St. Louis, to North Dakota. And August 1856, it left St. Louis, bound for the frontier town of Omaha. And then on 1856, on September 5th, less than 1 hour north of Kansas City, the Arabia collides with a sycamore tree and snags. Her passengers and crew survive, but the 200-ton is lost. And then it says, you know, in 1877, they attempted to get the Kentucky bourbon. Now, a lot of people were after this boat for kind of like the oddball reasons, even in the early or late 1800s, because of the whiskey. There were supposed to be 400 barrels of whiskey along with this boat. So that's what they were after. They weren't after any of the other goods. But because there was a water table below the boat was encased in, then what was the difficulty of getting the boat was that, and that's why it took, you know, years later for people to really figure out how they were going to get this boat. Isn't that incredible, the size of that paddle wheel? Can you imagine this coming down the Missouri River or the Mississippi? You know, there's the rumor was that one of the riverboat captains that was starting to go blind talked about, you know, they were saying, hey, you know, eventually you're not going to be able to drive this boat up and down the Missouri River because the Missouri River changed its courses so many different times. It was so difficult to navigate. And he said, well, if I go blind, then I'll just navigate the Mississippi because anybody can do that. Isn't that incredible that that was the story? This is a story of the mule. Now, the mule that was tied to the deck was the only casualty. And here's what it says. The owner of the mule was interviewed shortly after the sinking of the Rebbe. He reported that he tried to free his mule, but it was too stubborn and would not leave the sinking steamboat. The mule would absolutely tell a different story because he was firmly tied to the wood. So they found this right here, if you can imagine this, right? They found the bones of this mule, and there he is. And he was firmly tied to the deck. So I don't think the owner actually really worked too hard on getting the mule released. How incredible is that? That is really a, you know, years later, if you lie, they're gonna find you out, I guess, is what that really means. I mean, I just find this to be fascinating. I mean, the goods that were on this boat. If you can imagine today, like a modern day Walmart, that what got sunk, this is exactly really what you're dealing with here. Is this is so incredible that this is this even exists. And you know, here's the story, really. You know, here's Greg right here. And I went to school with Greg, and you know, he was tragically killed in a car wreck in 2009 in the pursuit of doing what he loved to do. They were hunting another boat. And so, you know what? And he even told me when they did this, you know, it was more, I mean, the connection I have with him is they weren't archaeologists, and I'm not an archaeologist. They weren't historians. He's not a historian. They were dreamers that just dreamed that, you know what? If you want to do this kind of stuff, you can. You know, if you've got a dream, then don't let the dream go, regardless of what that is. And you don't have to have a doctorate degree. Not that there's anything wrong with that if you do. But you don't have to have a doctorate degree to be able to chase your dream. All you got to do is have the desire. So, you know, with Greg, I tell you what, it was a sad deal. But you know what? You know, this museum is really the marker of his life because they accomplished this goal when everybody said that, you know what, that are not going to be able to. And, you know, I had talked to him last time I was here, and that had to have been, you know, forever ago, probably early 2000s, and he was hunting boats. And I said, man, I would love to go hunt boats with you. And he said, man, you are more than welcome. We'll go hunt boats. And so that excitement really hit me. But then we realized, then he passed. And but, you know, I didn't give up my dream either. I went to Phoenix and do what I do now. So how incredible is that? But tribute to him for living his dreams and showing people that, you know what, how incredible is this? Now, the snag that broke this broke down is right here, right? So there is the actual sycamore tree that actually, which was incredible, like the mule was tied to the deck. And here is the snag that actually caused that boat to sink. And it's pretty incredible still to be able to see that, see the exact snag that this boat hit when it came up the river. How incredible is this? And then the goods that were on this boat. Basically, it'd be like having a modern day Walmart as you come through here. That would be, you know, everything was on this boat. I mean, it's incredible. And a lot of things that you don't think about that would be in that time is here. And what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at all this, and we're going to take a look and see, you know, how incredible some of this stuff really is. You know, when they drilled for this boat, what they found out was, you know, there was going to be some casualties actually when they drilled a bit down. But, you know, there was a luxury side of these boats just as well. And so if you look at some of these pieces here, they got broke because of the drill bit. But, you know, that's definitely part of it. What an incredible journey. What an incredible area. You know, it basically says for the, you know, these were people's lost belongings here. Now, these weren't part of the boat itself as far as it's cargo. These were actually boots and jugs and items that that the people that were paying, and it says they were stowed like hogs, you know, so they had different classes in different areas of the boat. And and look at this picture right here of the bales. Unbelievable amount of cotton on that boat right there. How incredible is that? This place is just fabulous. I mean, now isn't that incredible right there? There is paint pigment. Now, from all the research we've done with the ancients, you know, one thing we've noticed is that, you know, how the pictographs of 800 years ago, how they used to design and build their own pigment, right? Well, they brought pigment themselves to trade for the later natives. And that's really pretty incredible. You know, there's Jim Bridger. He's buried in Mount Washington Cemetery, you know. And and it does say right there he was buried in Mount Washington. We've seen his monument in there. We look down here. Now, we're also studying Quantrell. Now, we visited Todd yesterday in Independence in his end, and there's John Brown. But, you know, a lot of these items that were brought down here in Arabia, they hold a lot of stuff that people believe could be detrimental to either the expansion of Kansas or Missouri. So when you look at these, you know, it says right here, pro-slavers boarded the Arabia in March of 1856 and confiscated these sharp carbines at Lexington. They are confirmed because of the serial numbers. It's absolutely incredible that these boats, because people feared that they were going to bring arms up here, so the Battle of Kansas was going to be difficult to have. So what you see is goods that would have come up that river. And how incredible is this? And this is a fabulous museum. This is really unbelievable, you know. And look at these goods of the children that used to be, you know, up here. And then it says this Charles was among the youngest passengers of the Arabia, being 6 months of age at the time of the sinking. You know, that sets him 2 years later. But that's incredible to see these people on these boats and living these lives. You know, now behind me is a very interesting piece. Now, if you look at it, what you're going to see is you're going to think that, well, maybe this is just some type of a drum. Maybe it's some type of smokestack. But you know what? What the truth is more incredible than that. What the truth is that this is a steel pipe that was put in the ground so they could try to find, on the first excavation, to try to find the whiskey in this boat. So if you look right here, what they did was they placed this in the ground, and then they went down to try to find the boat because this would seal it off from the water. A gentleman named Gail Dad Hansen of Holt tried to find the 400 barrels of whiskey, okay? And so how incredible was that? But if you look at the amount of boats that basically sunk, it's a pretty incredible story. So how many boats actually sunk on the Missouri River from St. Louis to South Dakota? 289 boats sunk all along this area. And it shows basically, you know, there was the Arabia there, but if you go down here, the Bennett and the Anthony Wayne, the A.C. Byrd, and on and on and on, 250 boats traveled that lost its way, that cracked. And that's how much, how devastating and difficult it was to navigate the river. You know, it talks here about the Pitman, right? Was the link between the piston rod and the steam engine, that's crankshaft of the paddle wheel. You know, it's really incredible how this worked and how they had this figured out to be able to power this boat, which was pretty incredible when you look at this. What an incredible, incredible place. And how this worked to be able to push this forward. In this case right here is these two sharps. Now these two sharps, because of the serial numbers, now these were actually confiscated. They stopped the Arabia in 1856, and they pro-slavers, so these would not reach Kansas, right? Because these guns here changed the West. This was an incredible gun that had an unreal ability to change the direction and the caliber of what was going to go on in the states of Kansas and Missouri, because this is where the most bloodiest battles of the whole Civil War were staged. And so this was an incredible place that it's unreal what they have learned through here. Now this is one of the areas right here where they do the cleaning of all the stuff and the drying. Now look in here, for example. This is the preservation lab. Look at, now, the thing to think about is this. It's really overwhelming. And even Greg told me, you know, they were looking for a couple guns that they could sell and maybe get enough money to do the next one, right? They weren't looking to make a museum. He said the last thing they had in their mind was to build a museum, right? But that's just not how it worked. And all of a sudden, that one boat, and they planned to dig hundreds, was the one that, you know, the second boat basically was the one that really hit it off. And so even today, they are still preserving the stuff, and they still are not done. That's how much footage. Now look in here at all these boots. Can you imagine how cool that would be?
All right.
You know, when I talked to him years ago, how much is still left to try to restore?
We have about 50 tons of stuff still back here in our storage facility. It's just duplicates of everything that you've seen out here. I'd say most of it's probably the cast iron stove pieces, like some of the ones down there, which are incredibly heavy. So naturally we have bunches of those. We have a couple thousand more shoes to go through, all which have to be stitched by hand like this. And cow hides, things like that.
So there's still 50 tons of stuff that you have. And that's been how many years now?
Over 30.
So because it's incredible how much stuff is still available. So how did you get involved in restoration type of stuff? That seems like something that the average person wouldn't say, well, what do you want to do or be?
Well, actually for freshwater preservation like this, it's a very niche thing. So even if I were to go to school for archaeology or things like that, you wouldn't actually end up with the training you need for freshwater things like this. You'd do saltwater and dry archaeological things, but not this. So they actually do all of their training for using the polyethylene glycol and the freeze dryers is all in-house training. My background is formally in linguistics and education, but I work from home and I just work very near here. I love history, I like sewing, I like talking to people, so kind of seemed like a natural fit.
Okay, that is awesome. So what's the most difficult thing about any of this restoration that you can think of that makes it?
Probably probably the fragility of a lot of it.
Right.
So we have to keep the shoes and the woods wet while we're working with them, otherwise they shrivel up. There's two rolling pins down here, and that kind of shows you about 48 hours of difference between one that has been kept wet and treated properly with the polyethylene glycol solution and then freeze-dried, and the other one was a day late. So they kind of collapse in on themselves, and same thing with the leathers. Any of the organics, they no longer have their naturally occurring cellulose to keep the cell structures strong internally. That's all been replaced with water. So once the water leaves, there's nothing left to support the cells inside, so they just collapse.
So once it's restored, can it be put out, or does it always have to be in an area with a certain temperature or anything?
We try to keep the humidity down back there, especially in the summer months. If you look at like in the displays, you can see there is like a humidifier to keep everything at a nice normal room temperature. But I mean, these boots have been restored and they're just good to go. These ones have already been treated with the freeze dryer and all of that. And this shoe, one day, I'd say in a couple of months, will be out there too.
Excellent.
Yeah. I mean, wow. It's basically get the mud off and then stabilize it. So for things like dishes over here, it's just get the mud off and they're good to go. Any of the metal pieces, we're going to want to wash those off with the mud, and then so that they don't rust, now that they're above in the surface, you'll put them in tannic acid and then they're good to go. Otherwise, nothing rusted when it was underground because the mud was so, so dense where the Arabia lay that it was an oxygen-free environment. That's why the food didn't mold and the metals didn't rust and things like that.
Isn't that incredible how every you know, and again, if you're one of these people that just happened to dig the boat and you don't realize the difference in knowing what to do and how to preserve it and how to restore it, it's a pretty incredible thing to be able to, you know, to be able to see. 160 rubber combs. You know, you didn't even realize they had combs, but look at there's combs right here. And they're made of rubber. These are rubber shoes. And I didn't even realize that they had rubber shoes back then. Look at all of these shoes and boots in this location. I mean, horse bridles through here, you know, billfolds, coin purses, things like that. I mean, look at that shirt right there. How incredible is that? Look at socks, coats, pants. Look at all these buttons. You know, in today's money, I mean, look at the hats back there. I mean, everything that would have put you into a period of dress is here. Now, one thing that we learned out yesterday was that you could have empty bottles, and when you got to the West, if you were a freighter, you could sell them empty bottles for 3 times the amount of money, empty, than you paid for them new with stuff. So how incredible is that? Look at all the things that you would have needed, you know, hatches, picks, shovels, I mean, everything, saw handles. I mean, everything that you would have needed in the Old West is available here. Pocket knives, I mean, on and on and on. You could come in here and see clothespins. I mean, everything that you could dream of was on this boat. Writing pins, bells. I mean, again, this was a Walmart. Look at the buckets. I mean, this is all original stuff. And now we get in here to the glassware. Look at the brass spoons. I mean, this is, and a lot of times what you think is, you think it in the 1850s, say, you don't really believe that you had all this stuff available. And look how incredible that is. I mean, look at, you know, a buddy of mine collects glass bottles. Look at that. How would you like to own the original glass bottles? See, everybody thinks they were completely backwards. But look, look at these shoes right here and this hat. I mean, that hat was all these goods in scale, right? I mean, this place is just, Now, this is stuff that was on the boat that was from everywhere around the world, right? So there is Wedgwood china from England that was on this boat. There's coffee beans that were from South America that was on this boat. There's writing pens from France, perfume from France, trade gun and flintlock from Belgium. And then we look over here and we see porcelain buttons from France, and then trade beads from Italy and Bohemia that were on that. Look at that, isn't that incredible? This was all on that boat. Stuff from around the world. And you know, you want to think how primitive this stuff was, and the reality was, is my gosh. And can you imagine they found all this stuff on one boat? There's candles still left. Coffin screws. So if you needed a coffin screw to put a coffin, why they had coffin screws, I'll have to check that out. I'm not even aware of that. And then look through here, all the files and things like that. Hammers, vices. Look at the keys. Look at the writing instruments for pens. And then the hair pins right here. And the thimbles. And the buttons. And then this glassware right here. How incredible is this? Now, let's look at the bottles. So what was in here? Cosmetics, Western Mills spices. Look, there's still sweet pickles in the jars. There's ketchup, okay? There's stomach bitters, assorted pie fruit. So there's fruit in these jars, still from that era. And then what is that right there? Gin, they still had gin. Oysters, there were oysters in cans, and there were pickled relishes right there. I mean, who would even have dreamed that this stuff would have even been available or here? And this is a time capsule. Look at all the shoes. It goes to show you how important shoes were back in that era, because this boat's contents of all the shoes is absolutely unbelievable. You know, when you look at a shirt like that, now that shirt down there was used by, it says by pro-slavery, and it's got a heart on it. Now, what a lot of people don't realize is that those guys were dressed like rock stars. You would think that they looked like Jimi Hendrix. I mean, how they dressed was a big deal. And they had ruffled shirts and flowered shirts, and they had things that you wouldn't have thought, and frilly. And you look at the old pictures of Bloody Bill Anderson and all the clothing that he used to have, and then you look at Jesse James and the garb that they used to wear and how important it was what they looked at. Now you look at those boots over there with the kind of a symbol on the top of them, I'd give my right arm to have a pair of those. And they look cool today. That's what's kind of funny about this, is that they really look interesting even today. Pretty incredible. Well, you know, that's going to do it. I got my traveling partner, Boogie, here today, and we're gonna get out of here, but I tell you what a fabulous, fabulous place. If you're ever in Kansas City, please come down and see this museum. It's spectacular, it really is. And it's a private museum. I mean, it's because they got all this stuff done. And you know, they probably had the opportunity at one time or not to separate this entire stuff, and you know, they didn't choose to do that. They choose to keep it intact, and the only way they can keep it intact is to be able to make sure people come see it. So if you get a chance, please come see this museum. Jay Schreck.
Steam engines
on the road to history.
Boilers boiling up the Mississippi and down the old Missouri. This is the ballad of the steamer of Arabia, the story of her seasoned crew. Through snags and danger, them boys were never strangers to living by the river's rules.